celebrating 40 years of the Doonesbury universe and its legacy. Jeffrey Brown talks to its creator.
In October 1970, a young man in a football helmet going by the name B.D. met his new college roommate, one Mike Doonesbury. In the 40 years since, those two and a cast that's grown by the dozens and into several generations have inhabited the phenomenon known as Doonesbury, one that has entertained and provoked readers as part baby boom generation chronicle, part sharp political commentary, and, oh yes, part very funny comic strip. In 1975, its creator, Garry Trudeau, became the first comic strip cartoonist to win the Pulitzer Prize for his Watergate cartoons. Decades later, he's brought new attention to the valor and suffering of contemporary war veterans, working with the Defense Department and visiting Walter Reed and other military hospitals. Looking back at it all, the brand new 40, a Doonesbury retrospective, has just been released. And Garry Trudeau joins me now. Welcome to you.
Thank you so much.
In the introduction to this new collection, you write that it is not about Watergate, gas lines, Reaganomics, Monica, all these things that you've sort of written about, in fact, over the years. What is it about? And what now, in retrospect, is Doonesbury about?
Well, I think what it began as a kind of diary of my generation coming of age became the main driving force behind it. It's just inherently fun watching a generation evolve to see what it's meant to
that's
be.
That's what you've always thought about it. I'm going to watch my generation evolve.
I think so. I don't think it was. I had quite such a grandiose take on it. Mm-hmm. I was just trying to get through the day and mm-hmm. create a series of jokes and meet a series of deadlines. But I think looking back on it, that's pretty much what it became. It was certainly marketed that way. That when this strip was taken out to editors, and it was a very old-fashioned business. It was all relationships. The salesman would go to individual editors around the country and sell it one by one. And I think the way they framed it was, look, it's a little amateurish. He doesn't have the skill set that you normally associate with, a professional big-time comic strip. But it's fresh. It has a kind of authenticity that was sold as kind of dispatches from the front lines of the countercultural wars.
And all these characters that we became familiar with, B.D., Zonker, Joni Conkers, I mean, you can go on and on and on here. They're people that you knew or knew of and then exaggerated or what? And then put into the real world somehow, right?
Yes, I think that many of the characters, and I get into this in the book, were inspired by people I met, but they're rarely models. It's just a place to begin. It's a series of characteristics, and in many cases, I'd take someone who was wholly admirable and turn them into someone who was completely reprehensible. This is what I did to people I loved when I was first starting out.
Sweet, yeah.
Because they're just more interesting if they're not
more interesting to look at
if they're not prancing around as role models, but if they're flawed and there's just more you can do with them.
You know, some years ago I came to visit you in your studio, and I remember you telling me that you spend the beginning of your working day is really just reading the news, right? So, but why? I mean, how do you use the news for the strip?
Well, I just try to feed my head. This is one of the things that I most like about the internet and the surfing phenomenon is that I can link my way through, just follow my interests, and it's so quick to find myself in unexpected places. It's often such a pleasure to just follow my curiosity into places that I otherwise wouldn't have gone. But yes, I marinate in all this stuff that's happening around me. Sometimes an idea will occur to me quickly, and by Thursday I'm hard at work on it. I send out a casting call. I decide which characters will work best.
Where does that call go to?
It just goes to some place in the lizard brain where everybody lives. And I try to figure out if there's a character that works for the idea. If not, I'm perfectly happy to create new ones. I've just created two new ones in the last couple weeks just because there wasn't anyone quite right for what I had in mind.
You know, because of the political edge, you have seen the strip moved around, right? In some cases, many cases moved off the comics page into the editorial page, sometimes taken out altogether. we call it the funnies, right? The funny pages. I mean, what is the role, what is the place, I guess, for political satire? Where does it belong, do you think?
Well, I think that if it were strictly political satire, it would be easy to make the argument, as many editors have, I think speciously, that it belongs on the op-ed page. And the reason I
said... You have fought that.
I have fought that because you know, I have long extended periods of time where I'm telling stories that aren't necessarily edgy or topical or anything that would justify putting them on that page. So we have respectfully requested that newspapers put us back on the comics page.
I want to ask you about one strip before we finish here, which goes to this most recent focus on the war injuries, and that's the strip in 2004 where BD, one of the original characters, right? We find that he's lost his leg in battle. We also find that he has lost his helmet for the first time. Readers see him whole in a sense, right? We see his hair, his head, but we also see what's happened to him.
Right. It took on this kind of metaphoric resonance that was not wholly intentional. I was racing through that particular strip. It was the end of a 3-day reveal where BD's lost consciousness and he's cutting in and out, and his teammate is trying to keep him alert because he has a better chance of surviving. And in the last panel, the camera, if you will, pulls back, and we see, looking right down on BD on a stretcher, that he's missing his leg and he's missing his helmet. The decision to remove the helmet came at the last second. I was trying to sort through the details of what happens to somebody during that golden hour on the battlefield, and I was saying, what's important to include and not to? Well, they take off the helmet. I thought, aha, take off the helmet. That works on a number of levels. And so I just scrawled in a little matted, wet hair on top of his head. I didn't think about how he was going to look later. I figured I'd worry about that later, mm-hmm. and just barely made my deadline. And I had all these consequences that I then had to live with. I'd never, I think, in any one particular strip ever signed on for this tremendous rolling responsibility that telling that story would entail. And
you
so here
that,
I am.
Huh?
I felt it then. I felt the weight of it then. But I got a lot of help very early on. The next day, I was contacted by the Department of Defense, and they said, you know, we see where you're going with this, and we suspect you might need some help. So I was invited down to Walter Reed to start talking with warriors and caregivers.
So when you went through all this, finally, when you went through all this 40 years of strips to put this together, did you feel a coherence, a cohesion to the tale that you had put together? I mean, after all, you're doing sort of day by day by day. Then you add it up. What does it add up to in 40 years?
I think that, yes, it sort of took me by surprise that it had a kind of novelistic totality that certainly was unintentional. I'm a short order cook. I'm just trying to get through the week. I'm just trying to push the story forward a little bit, and I do that in the most erratic way possible. I do a week at a time, and sometimes I'll do a Thursday strip, and then I'll have to reverse engineer it to figure out how I got there. And so I kind of lurch along, telling little bits of the story, and try to imagine the next few steps ahead, and that's about it. So it was very surprising to step back, to go through the 40 huge notebooks, one per year, mm-hmm. To edit this book down, and to see that it actually told a story of a generational journey and the beginnings of another journey, the generation that has followed.
All right, 40 years of Doonesbury. Garry Trudeau, thanks for talking to us.
Oh, my great pleasure.